Good morning, everyone. My name is Dr. Igor Nikolic. I'm an assistant professor at the Delft University of Technology and a senior visiting research associate at the Environmental Change Institute, University of Oxford. And this is where I'm speaking to you from. This is the next installment of the NGI MOOC, and today we will be talking about agent-based modeling. But before we start, let's consider something that you will do tonight. Tonight, when you go home, you will perform a seemingly insignificant, simple action. You will arrive at home, you will notice that it is dark, and you will go click, turn on the light. And suddenly, because at the same time when you are doing this, millions of others are doing the same thing, a overall pattern, overall order, and overall emergent presence of humanity becomes visible on the face of the earth. Now, nobody has told us collectively when to turn on the lights and how to make sure that we become visible through space. No, this is a consequence of individual actions, of individual choices, all happening at the same time. And how do these things come to be? Where do systems come from? How come that we are collectively able to do that? Well, just think about it. The world that you are part of is a large, complex, adaptive system. There is myriads of technical things, wires, transformers, switches, machines. There's lots of people, large transport systems, energy production, laws, regulations, habits, all sorts of things going on at the same time, all over the place, acting, interacting with each other to create this overall beautiful blue marble with lights on them that we see. So how does one even go about trying to understand all these interconnected systems that adapt, grow, and evolve? Well, this is the lecture on agent-based modeling. So this is obviously how we're going to approach it. So agent-based modeling, what is it? Why should you care? So what will be discussed today is the following. We will talk about what an agent is and what agent-based modeling is. I will show you a number of examples and help you understand when and how to use agent-based modeling, and I will try to give you some pointers to help you explore agent-based modeling on your own. So, without further ado, let's start. Well, agent-based modeling is a technique that comes from the Complex Adaptive Systems Toolkit. It is something that has been around for quite a while, but it's only recently that computers have become powerful enough to really use it to its full potential. And one of the great thinkers in the field, Joshua Epstein, has once said, if you did not grow it, you did not explain it. Now, this approach is called generative science, and this is what is at the heart of agent-based modeling. So it is all about understanding the world, or the phenomena of the world, from bottom up. It's a very multidisciplinary approach used for understanding complex systems, and it is really about understanding how things develop rather than how things are. So it is all about the process of interaction and action and reaction with individuals giving rise to a pattern that we observe. So, how this is done? Well, we will start by situating an autonomous heterogeneous agents or entities or things in some kind of relevant environment, in space or network or whatever. We will let them act and react and interact following relatively simple individual rules. Then these interactions will generate or grow this observed macroscopic pattern that we're interested in. For example, if you care about how the stock exchange behaves and why is it going up or down, one way to understand it would be to look at many individual investors and decision makers, see how they act and react, looking at what others are doing, what the environment is doing, and understanding how the pattern comes to be. Alternatively, what we also can do is if we have a collection of individuals that we understand very well, so we know how this firm behaves, we know how this government behaves, we can then explore and simulate what kind of behaviors are they capable of in the long run. So, how does this work? Well, we sometimes say that agent is a thing that does things to other things. So, why is this important? Well, just look at the image. You see in the middle there is this agent, an entity, a thing that knows things and does things. Now this thing is situated in a model, in some kind of environment where there's other agents, which sits inside a model that we as a modeler have chosen and drawn boundaries around. We have said this belongs to the system, this does not. Now, looking at these agents, following inputs from others, from the environment, and from their own behaviors, they will make decisions and they will perform actions. Now, these actions can affect themselves, they can affect the environment around, they can affect other agents. Now, there even might be many other agents that are acting, interacting on their own without having direct interaction with you, the agent. But because they change the environment that they're in, they might indirectly affect you. So it is literally the thing that does things to other things that gives rise to a pattern of interaction. Now, what are the components of such an agent-based model? Well, first, clearly, it's the agents, the entities, the things themselves. Now, then their states, then their decision rules, the actions that they perform, the environment that they're in, and the time in which they exist. So let me discuss these in a little bit more detail and give you an insight how it works. The agents themselves, as I said, they are things that do things to other things. This agent can be anything really, anything that you care about and you think is worth exploring. For example, individual people, firms, organizations, ideas, countries, technologies, bacteria, whatever you really care about. The key, however, is to identify a relevant entity that has a boundary, that has a clear inside and an outside, that has an internal state, has decision-making processes, and is capable of actions. So, the states then. The states are the things that the agent knows or has. They can be public or private, such as my location, my color, my assets, you know, what is the content of my wallet, for example. And I can tell you, being an academic, it's not a lot. But the things that I have that allow me to reason on and make actions based upon it. So it's the things I know or have. Now, the decision rules, as you can see here, are the decision and transformation rules that take inputs and my states and convert them into some kind of actions and overall behaviors. These things can be static or dynamic. And for example, as you can see on the slide, here is a simple reasoning logic for setting a price of a product you're selling based on the cost plus margin mechanism. Now, this can be very elaborate. People have done very crazy adaptive things like genetic algorithms, genetic programming, all sorts of things. Or they can be very simple as if then. If it rains, and if I do not have an umbrella, I will have to buy an umbrella not to get wet. And then action becomes the buying, and the state is being wet, yes or no. Now, the actions and the consequences of the decision-making processes, the result of those, and agent will perform or not perform some action. Now, this is important to realize that agents are autonomous. They can choose not to act, whereas if you're dealing with, for example, object-oriented programming, an object will always do what you ask it to do. With agents, you'll say, well, it's your turn to act. Agent will consider its environment, consider its state, make the computation that it needs to do, and then decide whether to act and how to act. Now, this action can be based on some input from other agent in its own state or on some kind of internal decision rules. And these actions can affect other agents. They can affect their own rules, their own states, or they can affect the environment. And it is often through this indirect interaction throughout the environment that the true complexity of the system arises. Now, the environment. Now, environment is a thing that the agent is in, everything that's not an agent, but is relevant. Now, this environment provides the agent with structure and information. So, for example, if I'm an investor agent trying to decide whether to build a power plant, I might consider the cost of capital, the interest rate. This is not something I can control, that's not something that's part of me, but that is something that the external world sets. So the environment affects the agent, and in some cases, agent may affect it as well. It also provides structure, it provides space through which we interact. For example, an agent can be on a grid, so I can have 8 neighbors around me, and I only know of those 8. Or I could be in a physical space, for example, on a GIS map. So I can say, well, this agent is 3 kilometers away from me or 2 meters. I could be in a network, so I could have a network environment where I can say my first degree neighbors, second degree neighbors, and so forth. Now, finally, the aspect I want to discuss is time. Now, time is a very peculiar thing, excuse me, in agent-based modeling, as time takes place in discrete steps, in ticks. And between 2 ticks, we assume that everything happens at once. Now, why do we do this? Well, if you remember from the opening, the complexity is all about things happening at the same time across the space, acting, interacting all over the time. Now, it is this parallelism of the real world that we're trying to capture when we build agent-based models. Now, given that computers are sequential processing machines, we have to allow things to happen at the same time, even though they're happening one after the other. So we assume that between two steps, between two ticks, everything happens at once. So the order or the sequence of agent interaction is very important. Because if you can, as you can imagine, if a certain agent always goes first, for example, is always allowed to buy first, it will buy the cheapest resources, for example, and always have an advantage. So we shuffle the agents every time step, allow them to take turns performing their actions, and by this we simulate a parallel action that we observe in the real world. Now, let me give you a very simple example of how this works. Now, as I opened with this wonderful blue marble image of our planet, what has happened there is individuals arriving home, experiencing an environmental change. They see dark, they see other agents choosing to turn on the light or not, and based on inputs of others, on their own preferences, they decide to turn on the lights. Now, nobody coordinates when the lights turn, but because we are very similar in many ways as humans, we will roughly do that at the same time, and we will see the lights of the world come up. Now, let me give you a slightly more complicated example, and one that is at the so-called operational scale, something at a short time scale where it's all about how exactly actions are performed. Now, what you see here is a simulation of the Airbus A380 evacuation plan. Now, as you might be aware, before an airplane is put into production and before use, it has to pass certain requirements in terms of how quickly it can be evacuated. Now, normally you would do this with many individuals, many participants, volunteers. You'll put them in the plane, tell them fire, and they have to run outside as quickly as possible. Now, this is expensive and takes a lot of time, because then as you decide that they're not moving fast enough, you will have to adapt the layout of the seats, move the exits, things like that. Now, what Airbus has done in this case is it has simulated human behavior, individual behavior, in a computer as agents. Now, these agents follow rules that are observed when humans are in panic and try to run away. And they can simulate time and time over to see how quickly people can evacuate the plane. And the emergent pattern from this interaction of bumping into each other, trying to squeeze through a tight spot, is the movement patterns in the evacuation time that results. Sorry about that. So, this is a very operational, short time scale example where we try to understand an emergent pattern at a short scale. Now, at a medium time scale, at a more tactical time scale, there is this other example of, for example, of a refinery. Now, this is work done by a colleague of mine, Dr. Van Dam, who has looked at the purchasing strategy and the effects it has on the performance of a refinery when the refinery is facing delays and disruptions in its crude oil supply. Now, in this case, the agents are multiple departments. They all have their own internal logic, the internal goals they're trying to achieve, and they're trying to cooperate and make money at the same time, and they're experiencing these delays as, for example, weather disrupts ships. Now, the individuals here, again, as I said, are the departments, and the overall pattern is the performance and efficiency and the profitability of the entire plant. Now, at the long term, at a strategic level example, there is wonderful work by my colleague Dr. Chapin, who has looked at the effects of carbon tax on carbon trading and power generation in the Netherlands. So here we have the agents that are energy companies that own multiple facilities that experience changes in prices and changes in electricity demand, and they have to make decisions on whether to invest, whether to divest, whether to buy one kind of fuel, other kind of fuel, interact with each other through markets, and the overall emergent pattern will be various levels of CO2 emissions and CO2 reduction and various electricity prices. So this is obviously something that happens over decades, compared to the Airbus example that happens in minutes. But you can still use an agent-based model in a very useful fashion to explore how individual interactions, individual decision-making processes affect an overall pattern. And here, in this final slide, you can see an example of a running simulation. This is power plants making decisions, investing into new facilities. You see that the generation profile is changing. There is more electricity produced from one source than from the other. You will see that the CO2 market is changing. you can see all sorts of dynamics happening over time as agents act and react. Now, with this, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I hope I have given you a basic understanding what an agent-based model is and how you can use it. Now, to wrap up, I would like to point at several resources that might be useful for you to continue studying this topic. And of course, please post any questions you may have on our discussion forum. So, further reading. First, I encourage you to download NetLogo. NetLogo is a free and open source agent-based modeling platform that is very well suited for teaching and studying agent-based models. There is the link where you can get it. Book by Joshua Epstein, Generative Social Science, that talks about how does one explore social phenomena from the bottom up. I've already mentioned Joshua Epstein, but I do strongly suggest reading that book. Furthermore, there are two open courses that I offer online. That the first one, SPM 4530, deals with complex adaptive systems and a short introduction to agent-based modeling. And the other course, SPM 9555, deals with advanced agent-based modeling and takes you in great detail through how to build complex models. Finally, when you're ready to dive even deeper, there is a book called Agent-Based Modeling of Socio-Technical Systems, edited by me, my colleagues, Dr. Van Damme and Dr. Luxo. There it is online. You can check it out and delve into this topic far deeper. Now, I wish you a lot of fun and enjoyment studying agent-based modelings, and good luck